Quote from The Guardian, October 1988. On Sunday, the 30th of October 1988 at St. Clement Danes, the Queen Mother unveiled a statue of Lord Dowding, Commander-in-Chief throughout the Battle of Britain. The statue had to be paid for by some of his former pilots because the government would not find the money to celebrate the victor of the most crucial battle in the history of the British nation. In the first days of May 1940, the mighty German war machine rolled ominously towards the frontiers of Luxembourg, Belgium, Holland and France, poised for the long-expected mass offensive in the West. After interminable delays, bad weather, complaints from the German High Command that the Wehrmacht and the Luftwaffe were in no condition after the Polish campaign for such an irreversible commitment, an impatient Hitler overruled all opposition. The assault on the West, codenamed Feldgelb, Case Yellow, was declared on. In the dawn of May the 10th, 1940, the awesome army of the Third Reich smashed its way into Holland. With terrifying efficiency, the conquerors of Poland and Czechoslovakia carved a lightning swathe of devastation through Holland and on into Belgium and France, leaving in the smoking ruins of towns and cities the dead and homeless of a people too stunned to resist the terrifying intensity of the onslaught. The nightmare of Blitzkrieg had come to the West. Within 5 days, Holland had capitulated. Rotterdam was in ruins, and everywhere the Allied forces were in retreat or offering futile resistance to the superb twin military operations of the Wehrmacht and the Luftwaffe, with its terror weapon, the Screaming Stuka. By May the 24th, Belgium had surrendered, leaving only the Dunkirk corridor, 15 miles wide and 50 miles long, in the hands of the remnants of the British Expeditionary Force and the armies of France. Unexpectedly, Hitler halted the relentless onward surge of the Wehrmacht 13 miles from Dunkirk, allowing the straggling Allies to reach the beaches. Marshal Hermann Göring, the flamboyant World War I air ace and personal friend and successor to Hitler, eager to add to the glory of the triumphant Luftwaffe and his own personal prestige, had promised the Führer to turn Dunkirk into another Warsaw and Rotterdam. "I will leave no stone unturned on another," he boasted. He was given his way. But his aircraft and pilots were battle-weary from the incredible speed of the offensive and had suffered their own losses in the Blitzkrieg. They were met with fierce opposition from the British Fighter Command, the one arm of the British military still able to offer resistance. This was due to one man, Air Chief Marshal Sir Hugh Dowding, who incredibly at that time was under notice to retire. Dowding, an eccentric loner, was also a man of vision and implacable will. General Sir Frederick Pyle, Commander-in-Chief of Britain's anti-aircraft defences, said of him, "A difficult man, a self-opinionated man, a most determined man, and a man who knew more than anybody about all aspects of aerial warfare." Dowding and a few lone realists had, against petty animosity and jealousy, managed to extract a commitment from the government to build 608 Hurricanes and Spitfires by 1940, the narrowest of margins for resisting the Luftwaffe. Yet in that year, Dowding watched with anger and frustration as his precious fighter force, pilots and planes, was tragically drained away on the fields of France. Although blamed for not protecting the retreating army, it was fighter resistance beyond the beachheads which had harried the Luftwaffe and made the evacuation from Dunkirk possible without colossal carnage. Although leaving their equipment behind on the battlefield of France, the nucleus of an army, 338,000 troops, had lived to fight on. More important in Dowding's eyes, among the tattered army lifted off the beaches were experienced pilots, British, Polish, Czechoslovakian and Commonwealth, who would be vital in the coming months. The Poles alone would account for 7.5% of the kills in the coming conflict. Such was the driving force of their hatred for the German invaders who had raped their homeland. By June 1940, Hitler's victorious armies stood along the European coast from Norway in the north to the French Pyrenees. The Battle of France was over, the Battle of Britain about to begin. Already, British shipping was being attacked in the Channel. Opinion in some quarters of the continent gave Britain 3 weeks before inevitable surrender. Frustrated by Britain's refusal to sue for peace, Hitler prepared to embark on the invasion, something to which neither he nor the High Command wished to commit themselves. From three different beachheads, 41 divisions, including six panzer, a total of 260,000 men would be launched. The operation was codenamed Sea Lion. The success of the plan rested solely on the Luftwaffe guaranteeing control of the skies above the invasion area, if embarkation ports were to be protected and invasion craft assembled and launched, secure from air attack and from the Channel fleet. If the generals and admirals of the German High Command had any doubts about the feasibility of invasion, the Luftwaffe, confident in their ascendancy, had none. Goering promised to clear the skies of all enemy aircraft in 4 days, and within 4 weeks to have totally annihilated the Royal Air Force. In preparation for this, new airfields were being built as near as possible to the battle area. Across the Channel, the people of Britain waited. They'd already seen the results of Blitzkrieg and seen major European cities in flames. Guernica, Warsaw, Rotterdam. The common belief in that summer of 1940 was that Britain would suffer the same fate. Britain was no longer secure in its island fortress. The seriousness of the threat could be seen in the mainland stations and bus terminals throughout the country as thousands of children were moved out of the cities to safer places. The wealthy moved their children not only out of the cities, but out of Britain, abroad.
Here they are.
They'll be very happy with you, I'm sure.
But as Britain frantically prepared herself against the threat, an invasion panic mounted with cruel internments of aliens and rising fifth column hysteria. One man, Dowding, remained coolly detached. Having managed to preserve at least half of the 52 frontline squadrons needed to defend the country after the Battle of France, Dowding could now concentrate on his 4-point master plan of defense. A fighter strike force of Spitfires and Hurricanes. A superbly flexible radar fighter direction system which the Germans could only guess at. A defense shield of anti-aircraft cover. And a brilliantly simple defense strategy. Dowding's strategy meant that while Group 11 in the south of England flew to intercept raiders, Group 12 further north and Group 10 in the southwest would cover the unprotected airfields. The strategy was to break up the bomber attacks before they could reach their targets, without committing too many valuable squadrons at one time, but leaving adequate air cover for the bases of the squadrons involved in the battle. The battle was to be controlled from one central command at Bentley Priory. Information gathered from radar stations around the coast, plus visual observations, were to be fed into control center, where the overall command decisions would be made and the battle strategy controlled. Orders for fighter interception would then be fed to Group HQ's sector and satellite airfields, and the fighters guided onto their targets. As the Luftwaffe made its first attacks on coastal targets in Britain and the aerial conflict intensified, it was soon clear that this would be a battle between three planes. For the Luftwaffe, the tried and tested Messerschmitt Bf 109 would be pitted against Fighter Command's twin fighter weapon of the Spitfire and Hurricane. These three would be the thoroughbreds of the coming battle. The Bf 109, designed by the brilliant young Willy Messerschmitt, was destined to be one of the most formidable fighters in the world. With a long pedigree, evolving from the little Messerschmitts of the 20s, it was developed to become the ideal single-seater fighter. Fast, graceful, and highly maneuverable, it possessed considerable firepower in the shape of two 2.79mm MG-17 machine guns on the engine crankcase and two 20mm MG-FF cannons in the wings, with a top speed of 375 miles per hour, and an exceptional dive capability. Its only potential rival in overall combat would be the legendary Supermarine Spitfire, the jewel in the crown of Fighter Command. British designer Mitchell had given the RAF by the end of the 30s the equal of the 109 in the superb Spitfire. Comparable to the Messerschmitt in terms of maximum speed and agility, the Spitfire, although possessed of inferior destructive capability in the form of 8 303 Browning machine guns mounted in the wings, could, due to its lower wing loading, turn inside the 109 in a dogfight, and often gain a decisive advantage in the countless combats between the two. Lucky enough to capture a Bf 109 almost intact, the Air Ministry were able to carry out comparison tests, which demonstrated the outstanding class of both planes. The differences were marginal, but significant. The 109 was slightly faster than the Spitfire above 20,000 feet and had a faster rate of climb. But once it reached that height, the Spitfire was more agile. The Bf 109 was slightly faster in a dive because its engine was fuel injected. The Spitfire suffered momentary loss of power when it was nose over because the carburetor cut out due to the effects of gravity on the float. In essence, the Spitfire was marginally better all round at altitudes of less than 20,000 feet. As almost all air combat during the battle would be waged between 13 and 20,000 feet, this would be a telling factor. Despite the parity of these two fighters, a crucial handicap to the Messerschmitt in combat over Britain was to be its limited range, giving it approximately 15 minutes in the combat area before having to turn back because of lack of fuel, a superb advantage to the home-based RAF. Paradoxically, despite the excellence of the Messerschmitt and Spitfire, the greatest contribution in terms of the number of kills would come from the sturdy Hawker Hurricane. Larger than the Spitfire, but powered by the same superb Rolls-Royce Merlin engine, the Hurricane could turn inside any contemporary fighter aircraft in the world. Allied to its durability, this factor rendered the often unsung Hurricane a highly potent factor in the battle. Both sides had superbly engineered fighter planes, which were about to be tested in an aerial conflict never before experienced or envisaged. But who was to fly them? Both Britain and Germany had lost experienced fighter pilots in the fighting on the continent. But the Luftwaffe still had a corps of fully trained Lufthansa pilots, schooled in peacetime for the inevitable war. While Fighter Command were dangerously low on battle experience and relied on part-timers and reservists who had either no battle experience or who had flown only near obsolete machines, not the Spitfires and Hurricanes of the coming conflict. The advantage lay with the Luftwaffe. Could the imbalance be adjusted by the RAF's advantage of playing a home match, that British pilots shot down could fight again, while an enemy pilot shot down over the British coast would almost certainly be imprisoned? Also, Fighter Command had only to defend, while the Luftwaffe, in the offensive role, had the double task of staying alive and protecting their bombers. In the first days of July, phase one of the German offensive began in earnest with attacks on British shipping and the mining of the Channel approaches. Night bombers made sporadic raids throughout Britain, while fighter packs swept the southeast to draw Fighter Command to battle. Dowding was under great pressure to retaliate. He did so, but sparingly, realizing that the major battle was still to come. By not delivering a lightning and heavy assault in the wake of the tattered Allied forces retreating from Dunkirk, Hitler had made his first mistake of the battle and had bought the RAF the precious commodity of time. Time to iron out the flaws in the radar network. Time to gain experience of German tactics. Time to build planes and train pilots. There were heavy losses on both sides. And by the second week of August, the RAF had lost 148 fighters, while the Luftwaffe had lost 286 aircraft, including 105 109s. Flaws in the RAF's fighter tactics were glaring. They'd not learned from France and still flew in dangerous close formation and in the traditional Vic pattern, vulnerable to attack from above and behind, with tail end Charlie the most vulnerable of all. Faced with an enemy who refused to oblige by flying on a steady path, the peel-off in-turn attack was nonsensical, especially with Messerschmitts waiting above to blast the unprotected belly or back of the fighter as it broke away from the attack. British pilots were forced to defy the official line, realizing that to guarantee the chance of a kill on a heavily armored bomber, the fighter had to get close. The pilots unofficially realigned their guns to converge not at 650 yards, but at 200 or 300 yards. Pilots, realizing it was their backs which were vulnerable, took to placing armor plating behind their seats, though the official view was that this would destabilize the aircraft. Official gear was discarded for combat efficiency or for a show of individuality. As for tactics, the RAF training manual was gradually discarded by the fighter squadrons. The complaint was that older officers may have attained high ranks, but were rarely seen at high altitudes. The old Vic formation was gradually replaced by the Mulder's Schwarm technique, known later to the Allies as the Finger Four attack, with covering defense of four aircraft flying in preset pairs. This allowed for a much looser, more flexible formation, even at squadron strength. But there were those in Fighter Command who questioned Dowding's tactics. This conflict with the supporters of the big wing theory of all-out assault on the enemy with as large a force of fighters as could be mustered exaggerated Dowding's already weak political position and resulted in incidents of dangerous defiance of the Dowding Park strategy. As much a conflict of personalities as ideas, it was to add unneeded stress to the touch-and-go tension of the battle. Dowding realized that by the time at least three squadrons could form a big wing attack on the enemy, the Luftwaffe would have had ample opportunity to reach their targets. It took a Luftwaffe aircraft up to 15 minutes to cross the channel. But according to ace Johnny Johnson, it took a squadron 17 minutes to get airborne and a further 20 minutes to form the big wing. Vital statistics in favor of Dowding's strategy. The days passed and the jousting continued. A new breed of air race, the Knight of the Air, was beginning to emerge, accompanied by glamorous media treatment from both sides. But the reality was different, and the battle anything but chivalrous. Jose Foso wrote, "I came very easily down behind him. I think it was a Hurricane on a test flight, because he was quite alone. I still feel very sorry for him, because when I opened fire from about 70 yards range, the aircraft simply exploded into a mass of fragments with no hope of survival for the pilot." Forced to bail out or to ditch in the channel, pilots found themselves in a devil or the deep blue sea situation. Having survived combat, only to run the risk of drowning, being shot at whilst parachuting, or even been mistaken for the enemy and shot by the trigger-happy home guard, whose fears of fifth column infiltration was acute. Even the Red Cross was not sacred, as the Germans discovered when Dowding ordered attacks on German rescue craft. Dowding was acutely conscious that this was a war of attrition. If a pilot was rescued, he would fight again, and the vicious killing circle would start all over. The British had virtually no air-sea rescue capability, and pilots relied on chance encounters with fishing, merchant and naval vessels. The Germans were better equipped with visible yellow helmets, flares and sea dye for their pilots. In terms of rescue craft, they had floating safety islands, Heinkel float planes and other rescue vessels. The pilots, not the planes, were the real phenomena of the Battle of Britain, on both sides. From all classes and nationalities, veterans and novices, idealists and cynics, whatever their motives, duty or hatred, whether they loved or feared flying, they had one thing in common: a peculiar madness which drove them again and again into the sky, not knowing if it was for the last, and for some, the first and last time. Legendary pilots like Mulders and Gallant, Townsend and Johnson dictated the tactics. But for many, it was follow my leader and, as one pilot put it, live and learn, if lucky. Amid the morass of conflicting tactics, there seemed to be one overriding maxim: get high, get in, kill, go home. A vague recipe for survival. In comparison with my combats in France, I was very calm. I didn't fire, but tried again and again to get into a good position. But every time I got there, the Tommy would break away. Finally, my chance came. Below, I saw a 109 and 200 meters behind him, a Spitfire. I peeled off and dived, turning in behind him. Now it was I who sat 200 meters behind the Tommy. Be calm. Don't fire yet. I applied full power and slowly closed the gap, as the Tommy did with his own target. Now at 100 meters, the wingspan filled the Revi gun sight. Suddenly the Tommy opened fire, and the Messerschmitt in front broke away. I had pressed the gun button at the same instant, aiming dispassionately as we went into a slight left-hand turn. My first shots hit. The Spit screamed a long, grey smoke trail and dived steeply into the sea just off the coast. A great column of water marked the impact. At once I called my victory over the radio and had enough witnesses to confirm the crash. My first Tommy was down. Max Helmut Ostermann. As the Luftwaffe began to build up its offensive, attacking in greater and greater force, Britain was feeling the strain of the battle. Pilots were tired after repeated scrambles, and pilot losses were acute. The planes were coming in increasing numbers from Lord Beaverbrook's well-oiled production machine. But who was to fly them against increasing forces of fighters whose speed and surprise from short range was beating the radar? The Luftwaffe was also feeling the pressure. Far from destroying fighter command in 4 days and mopping up the RAF in a matter of weeks, they were suffering serious pilot and aircraft losses against unrelenting resistance. The pilots began to question their invincibility, and discontent grew. Air ace Adolf Gallant wrote, "Two or three sorties daily was the rule, and the briefing read, free chase over southeast England. The physical as well as the mental strain on the pilots was considerable. The ground personnel and the planes themselves were taxed to the limit. Failure to achieve any noticeable success, constantly changing orders, betraying lack of purpose, and obvious misjudgment of the situation by the command, and unjustified accusations, had a most demoralizing effect on us fighter pilots. We complained of the leadership, the bombers, the Stukas, and were dissatisfied with ourselves. We saw one comrade after the other, old and tested brothers in combat, vanish from our ranks. Not a day passed without a place remaining empty at the mess table. The reproaches from higher quarters became unbearable. We had the impression that whatever we did, we were bound to be in the wrong. In those days, all the loudspeakers blared, for the greater German Reich, from Aachen to Tilsit, from Flemsburg to Innsbruck, and from the army stations of most of the occupied countries, blared out the song, Bomben auf Engeland. We pilots could not stand this song from the very start. On the eve of the long-awaited major offensive, Eagle Day, the 13th of August, in the belief that the RAF fighter squadrons were tied by radio telephone to their own ground stations and could not concentrate their strength, German intelligence wrote, "A mass German attack on a target area can therefore count on the same conditions of light fighter opposition as attacks on widely scattered targets." Again, German intelligence sadly underestimated the quality of the British defense system, and it was with confidence that the Luftwaffe commenced their mass offensive codenamed Adlertag, Eagle Day. On the 12th of August, the day before Eagle Day, the Luftwaffe attempted to blind Britain by knocking out its radar screen prior to the major assault. The elite 210 group's BF-110s launched a precision strike on four radar stations while BF-109 swept Kent to draw off the fighters. The mass attack did overload the RAF communication system. And helped by confusion in the central ops room at Bentley Priory, the raiders were able to cripple the radar installations at Dover, Dunkirk, in Kent, Rye, and Pevensey. Through the 100-mile gap torn in the system, the Stuka Gruppen attacked forward fighter airfields without loss. At noon, 100 bombers with heavy and light fighter support launched a heavy attack on Portsmouth docks and shipping. The Ventor radar station on the Isle of Wight was knocked out. Manston airfield on the coast was fiercely attacked. Other coastal towns were bombed. At the end of the day, fighter command had lost 22 aircraft against the Luftwaffe's 36. But within hours, four of the five radar stations were operational again. No decisive advantage had been gained. Eagle Day started in confusion. Having received a cloud warning, Goering issued an order postponing the assault. This failed to reach Kanal-Kampfführer Fink at his headquarters in Arras. The ineptitude of German radio communications was again demonstrated when the radio message to bombers failed to get through because the wrong crystals had been fitted in the radios. The message, however, reached the escorting Bf-110s, which returned home. The fleet carried on without escort. Although inflicting extensive damage on Sheerness and East Church coastal bases, Fink had lost 10 aircraft. The chaos continued throughout the morning. A bomber strike turned back because of bad weather. Another group was briefed, but then grounded. However, no one informed the escort, which lost a plane to the British fighters. The weather improved, and Eagle Day was declared on again. A massive airstrike on fighter command airfields was led by Stukas. Fighter command refused to be drawn by the fighter sweeps and concentrated on breaking up bomber attacks, particularly where the fighter escorts had turned back due to lack of fuel. On the 13th of August, only 700 sorties were flown by the RAF to the 1,485 of the Luftwaffe, whereas on many July days, they had flown 600 or more against far less odds. Dowding was still conserving his forces. 34 German aircraft were destroyed to 13 RAF fighters. 47 British aircraft were destroyed on the ground, but only one was a fighter. Britain had survived Eagle Day, the first major attack by the Luftwaffe. Dowding said of the day, "It's a miracle. The pilots were wonderful, but it's a miracle." 2 days later, in the belief that Dowding's forces in the north were stripped to defend the channel, Luftflotten 5 launched an attack from Norway. Trusting in a feint of Heinkel floatplanes to draw off any fighters from Air Vice Marshal Saul's 13 group, a fleet of Heinkels and Bf-110s took off without any light fighter escort. Lacking the experience of 11 Group, the radar operations in Northern Group only estimated a 30-aircraft attack and scrambled a single squadron. When the huge formation was sighted, the dismayed squadron leader radioed ground control. Risking everything that this was the Luftwaffe's only attack in the north, the controller scrambled every squadron from Yorkshire to Edinburgh. The Heinkels and the Bf-110s, who had left their gunners behind to save weight, were decimated. Luftflotten's 550 Ju-88 bombers met a similar fate at the hand of Lee Mallory's 12 group. Throughout the day in the south, the Luftwaffe continuously pounded airfields and radar stations with more success. The defenders suffered repeated losses from huge Bf-109 escorts. Damage to the radar network had dangerously hampered fighter interception. But the 15th was a disastrous day for the Luftwaffe. They had lost 76 aircraft against Fighter Command's 34. Air Fleet 5, without fighter cover, would never make a major assault on Britain again. The southeast of England was now the undisputed field on which the Battle of Britain would be decided. The offensive continued through August and into September, putting extraordinary pressure on Fighter Command. But the RAF had an unwitting ally in the capricious Goering. From his HQ at Carenholm, he made a series of disastrous strategic decisions. He ignored the Luftwaffe's successes against radar installations and issued a directive that no further effort be wasted on the network. He gave his air fleet commanders a free hand in selecting targets, reinforcing the Luftwaffe's failure throughout the battle to concentrate their strength on vital bases, factories and installations until they were utterly destroyed. Also, he emphasized the need to assault bomber command bases. But although actively raiding Germany and losing more aircrew than Fighter Command in the process, Bomber Command were not a prime military factor in the Battle of Britain. These three gross errors of judgment were a godsend to Fighter Command. As the battle continued, the true worth of the various aircraft and tactics were reinforced. The Bf 109 was matched by the Spitfire, but superior to the Hurricane. However, its short range diminished its worth as an escort on deep bomber raids. Park drew the right conclusions. The Hurricane should be used to attack the bomber formations, while the Spitfire would engage the fighter escorts. The German fighter pilots were burdened by yet another Goering dictate. On the 16th of August, British pilots reported German fighters in close escort of all bomber formations. This presented huge targets for the Hurricanes and Spitfires, while the tactic lost the 109 its advantage of height, maneuverability, and surprise. The Stuka may have had devastating effects on shipping and ground targets in situations of air superiority, but without protection, its slowness made it prey to fighters. The Stuka was phased out of the battle after suffering incredible losses. The British loved a Stuka party. The Bf 110's losses were also becoming embarrassing to the German High Command, who had thought their speed would allow them to fly unescorted. Still, the Luftwaffe continued to attack in massive force. On the 24th of August, the battle entered a new phase, which was the nearest Fighter Command came to destruction. Squadrons of Messerschmitts were moved to bases even closer to South England, and the Luftwaffe launched the long-awaited sustained onslaught on Fighter Command and its support structure, lasting well into September. During the last 10 days of August, Dowding lost no less than 126 Spitfire and Hurricane pilots, 14% of his strength. 60% of those lost were experienced pilots, while replacements were coming from either Bomber Command or from disastrously shortened operational training courses with only 10 or 20 hours in a Hurricane or Spitfire. Many of the new pilots were dead within minutes of their first sortie. But there was a similar drain on Luftwaffe fighter pilots, 15% in August, with the same decline in skill levels as the British. Parks and Dowding continued to resist enormous pressure from the big wing theorists, who demanded a showdown with the Luftwaffe. But Park ordered his group to protect the sector airfields at all costs. He ordered that there be no pursuit over the channel. Pilots were to avoid fighter-to-fighter contact and to go for the bombers. Fighter Command must continue to exist. By the 6th of September, Fighter Command was at the end of its tether, desperate with fatigue, dispirited, battered into near submission. Peter Townsend of 85 Squadron Croydon summed it up. "The shrill scream and the deafening cry of bombs shattered my sleep. In the doorway, young Worrell, new arrival, was yelling something and waving his arms. Normally frightened as anyone, not even bombs could move me then. I placed my pillow reverently over my head and waited for the rest. Worrell still had the energy to be frightened. I was past caring. It was a bad sign. I was more exhausted than I realized." This understated the incredible toll being taken, the physical exhaustion, the acute nervous strain, as pilots made scramble after scramble and the ground crew toiled under appalling conditions to keep the planes in the sky. 35 minutes to refuel and rearm a fighter while the pilot snatched the traditional cuppa before going up to kill again or be killed. It was a bizarre nightmare. The tired pilots made dreadful mistakes. Two returning Blenheims were shot down by Hurricanes who thought they were German bombers. One low-flying pilot, totally disorientated, riddled a tractor. fighter command was literally expiring. In the last days of August, 39 RAF fighters were shot down, and by that time, some fighter squadrons had almost ceased to exist as fighting units. The remarkable efforts of Lord Beaverbrook ensured a supply of fighters, but even he could not conjure up pilots to fly them. Yet, at this nadir of the battle, Dowding found a strange ally, RAF Bomber Command. In the past, Dowding had been in constant conflict with Bomber Command in his struggle to build up a fighter defense for Britain. The politically powerful and cosseted Bomber Brigade had always been given the cream of trained pilots and ludicrously biased funding. It must have appeared in the summer of 1940 as if Bomber and Fighter Command were fighting different wars, so unintegrated were their actions. Yet, by a quirk of fate, on the 25th of August, the RAF bombed Berlin as a reprisal for a freak accident Luftwaffe bomb drop on London. This event was to alter the course of the Battle of Britain. Bomber Command continued to assault Berlin and other German cities, and an outraged Hitler retaliated with a blitz on London. On the 7th of September, the Luftwaffe hit London docks. Keith Park, AOC of 11th Group, made the shrewd, if callous, observation where London was concerned. It was burning all down the river. It was a horrid sight. But I looked down and said, thank God for that, because I knew that the Nazis had switched their attack from the fighter stations. The great September raid on London docks was spectacular. The 33 squadrons which rose to meet the attackers saw an astonishing sight. The air was dark with aircraft, a mile and a half deep and covering 800 square miles of sky. It was awesome. 1,000 aircraft, a third of them bombers. The obvious target, the capital. The docks had suffered terribly. Warehouses crammed with highly flammable stockpiles burned uncontrollably, while firefighters from all over the south attempted the impossible. Almost 500 civilians were killed as the bombs dropped in a widespread over London. The continued raids on the following days confirmed that the German strategy had changed. On the 9th of September, some squadrons again disobeyed orders and flew to join the battle, losing valuable planes in the process. But with such obvious enemy numbers and a clearly indicated target, for once the big wing theory made tactical sense. Employed earlier, as a post-mortem suggested, it would have proved disastrous. On the 11th, the waves of the bombers continued to hit London. Fighter Command suffered severe losses, but the Luftwaffe formations were appalled to find themselves resisted by large waves of fighters. By embarking on this vengeance campaign, goaded by British bomber raids on Germany, Hitler had unwittingly reprieved Fighter Command, who now knew that the German target was London and could concentrate their forces, allowing respite for the battered pilots of Group 11. And giving the ground infrastructure a chance to be restored to a semblance of order. When the Luftwaffe resumed its bombing campaign on the 15th, they were met by a large, refreshed and prepared fighter force. 100 German bombers scattered over London and ran for the coast, stunned by the fierce resistance. The second German formation met a similar fate in the form of 170 Hurricanes and Spitfires, refueled and rearmed. At last, Fighter Command was strong enough to inflict decisive losses on the enemy. By the end of the day, Dowding had lost 37 fighters, but had destroyed 56 German aircraft. To everyone, except perhaps Goering, the writing was on the wall. The Luftwaffe had failed to smash fighter command and gain the control of the air that was vital for any hope of a successful invasion. The autumn weather was deteriorating. Hitler and the Army High Command clearly saw that the Luftwaffe had failed in its task. The fighter command was still in existence and still controlled the skies over the Channel. On the 17th of September 1940, British intelligence intercepted a German secret signal cancelling Operation Sea Lion. While fierce air fighting continued by day until October and night bombing throughout the winter, Dowding and his command had achieved victory, or at least avoided defeat. The Battle of Britain was over. Britain was still in the war, her morale high, and she had inflicted the first major defeat of German arms. News of the victory in occupied Europe was seen as a beacon of hope, and the voice of the pro-Nazi and peacemonger lobby in Britain and America, if not silenced, was at least muted.
German homeland, that war is not all loot and triumph. We shall aid and the people of every conquered country to resistance and revolt. And if driven to desperate hazard, he attempts the invasion of the British Isles, as well he may, we shall not flinch from the supreme trial. Lift up your heart. War will come right out of the depths of sorrow and of sacrifice. We'll be born again. The glory of mankind.
It was extraordinary that in this time of triumph, the very people who should have received the laurels of victory were treated with unbelievable ingratitude by the government. Dowding's and Park's strategy had been completely vindicated. Yet such was the political animosity and jealousy towards Dowding that he and Park's were virtually accused of negligence through overcaution. The big wing theorists did not win the Battle of Britain, but they destroyed Dowding in the end. Not long after the battle, Dowding was asked to clear his desk as the Air Council had no further work to offer. The official booklet of the Battle of Britain, published shortly after, made no mention of Parkes or Dowding.
If the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for a thousand years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.